co-organized this session with GIZ, the NDC Transport Initiative in Asia. I have a few slides just to put into context what we hope we're going to talk about in this session, this important session on electric two and three wheelers. But before that, we want to inform everyone that this session is recorded. If you are not familiar with Teams, we have here some instructions in terms of if you want to intervene. But always, you can ask your questions in the chat. But please do mute yourself if you are not speaking. We are on the fourth day of the Transport and Climate Week in the Asia agenda. I think we are the first for today. And we have a few more sessions until the end of the Transport and Climate Week. One thing I liked from the remark of the Minister of Federal Ministry for Environment in Germany, basically this Transport and Climate Week tries to get us all together despite the pandemic travel restrictions, and to continue coming together, sharing information, sharing experiences, and in the hope that we can address some of the problems that we have in our cities, in our countries, to reduce emissions, not only CO2, definitely, but also air pollution. But I think more importantly, to promote these more livable cities. Very brief, this avoid, shift, improve. It is always in, you've seen this many times for all the participants, I'm sure. It's very popular. It is also what is the basis for the Transport and Climate Week. And similarly, for this issue on electric two and three wheelers, it's not that we are just promoting this kind of technology to have a better and more sustainable transport systems. And we also need to look at other policies for sustainable transport. Just to put things into perspective, definitely we have, Asia has the most number of ICE motorcycles and scooters in the world. And if you look at information that is there for Southeast Asia, for Thailand, Indonesia, Vietnam, it is very high. It is the highest in the world. If there is data for Laos, Cambodia, Myanmar, I'm sure it will be very close. For other countries, definitely this is a major transport mode. And one thing that we should include and rightfully integrate in our national policies and local policies. In order to do that, we hope to understand, or I guess I say we should understand the role of two and three wheelers in transport systems. Widely used, many are dependent on these types of transport, particularly the marginalized sector, the poor sector of society. It's for passenger transport, freight, but also for public transport. And now, as we have all seen with the pandemic and restrictions on movement, the rise of the two-wheelers, bicycles, electric bikes, definitely motorcycles have become more important than ever. All of your deliveries at home for food or other services are now all delivered by motorcycles, some by bicycles, I guess very little with e-bikes. It's also important to put into to know or to acknowledge that a large percentage of our urban trips are within 6 kilometers. And this can easily be covered by walking, cycling, electric bicycles, and other motorized two-wheelers. This is information from an old study now from ADB and Cleaner Asia in 2011. But I was trying to get some information that tries to capture travel behavior in many cities. But this just shows, like, this is a quite comprehensive 6,600 survey or people surveyed from many cities. That looks at travel behavior. And here you can see that 60% of all trips have travel time less than 30 minutes and trip lengths less than 6 kilometers. There's also information on the people surveyed who primarily walk or primarily use bicycles or motorcycles. It is important to put this into context. I hope there could be another type of this kind of surveys across various cities in Asia, or if not the whole, if not the world. This is new information from our colleague Sudhir Gota, who was looking at this information on the global exports of bicycles and motorized two-wheelers. And if you look at this information, the growth now is for bicycles and motorized two-wheelers. And during this pandemic, 2020, you see a sharp increase in the number of bicycles. On the other hand, light-duty vehicles, freight vehicles, buses, it's all going down. I guess after the pandemic, this trend will shift, but I hope that we can keep the rise of bicycles, maybe other two-wheelers for that matter, to continue to increase, but properly integrated into our transport system. Now, this information is also quite new. And here you will see, compared to the ICE motorcycles, there's also information on the electric two-wheelers. And they define the electric two-wheelers as motorcycles, moped, cycles, having motor, electric motors that they use for propulsion. And look at that, a very high increase in the number of electric two-wheelers. While I don't have information for specific for Asian countries, I just like to remind, I guess, that the number of electric two-wheelers in China is very high, highest in the world. Number in India is also increasing, but definitely also now the number in Southeast Asia. 2017, this trend has started to increase, or I guess has been started to monitor. And this was also the time when there is more export of these electric two-wheelers in Southeast Asia particularly. So we are being flooded, I would say, by electric two-wheelers. And as such, there is a need for us in the countries to have better policies and regulations dealing with electric two and three-wheelers. Can be fiscal, regulatory, other soft measures, consumer information. And these are some of the policies that are being developed in this project that we are implementing with the support of the International Climate Initiative. We have East Africa and Southeast Asia as main focus, acknowledging that in Southeast Asia is the biggest market, but in Africa or in East Africa, this issue on two-wheelers is also becoming very important. And as such, we would like to include them. One thing just to highlight here, and I hope our panelists can address this issue later on, is on this issue of, we are always talking about electric cars, electric buses. There are manufacturing subsidies or targets, and also for electric motorcycles, but there are none for electric bicycles or electric cargo bikes for that matter. This is an important issue, and I think, and I hope we can be able to tackle later on. In UNEP, we are going to continue focusing on the electric two and three wheelers. There is a global electric mobility program, and we will involve particularly definitely our panelists here in a global working group that focuses on electric two and three wheelers. So going to our session for today, we will have two panels. One will talk about roadmaps and policies, and the other is in more general, like what are the prospects for electric two and three wheelers, or what is really happening on the ground. We are fortunate that we will be joined today by our colleagues, Pat Mariano from GIZ and Michelle Arndt from GIZ as well, who are technical advisors and part of the NDC Transport Initiative in Asia as well. So I guess without further ado, I would like to pass on to Pat Mariano from GIZ to facilitate our first session. Thank you very much and hope for very good discussions.
Thank you, Bert. And thanks again, everyone, for joining us today. We're going to have our first panel where we will look at the question, where are electric two and three wheelers in roadmaps and policies? For this first panel, we will have Dr. Yosapong Lau Noal, Professor Le Antoine, and Mr. Edmund Araga. So I'll just give a brief introduction of our panelists before we do the rounds and invite them to speak. As you saw from the agenda that Bert showed earlier, there is, after maybe 25 minutes, a chance for some Q&A. So please feel free to type your questions in the chat. And we can also ask you to turn on your video and mic later to ask your question in live. Okay, so Dr. Yosapong Lau Noal, sorry, did I get that correctly?
It's okay, yes, correct, yes.
Yes, thank you. So he is the former president of the Electric Vehicle Association of Thailand. and he is the current head of the Mobility and Vehicle Technology Research Center of the King Mongkut University of Technology, Thonburi. Dr. Yosapong is also part of the Council for Decarbonizing Transport in Asia, which is part of the NDC-TIA project. We also have Professor Lian Tuan, the chairman of the University Council, Hanoi University of Science and Technology in Vietnam, who is also part of the Council of Decarbonizing Transport in Asia. And lastly, from the industry, we have Mr. Edmund Araga, president of the Electric Vehicle Association of the Philippines, and also president of the Asian Federation of Electric Vehicles Association. Okay, so thank you for spotlighting our esteemed panel. I'll throw the first question now to Dr. Yosapong. Okay, so Dr. Yosapong, Thailand probably has the most advanced e-mobility roadmap in Southeast Asia with specific targets for production and use of EVs. Can you elaborate on these targets, how they were developed, and who were key from government in the development of these targets?
Sure. Then let me share the slide. Sure. Okay. Can you see it now?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, right. Thank you for inviting me to join these panels. Right. Well, I'm gonna give you some brief introductions about Thailand and some of their policies about electric vehicles. Okay. So this is the I'd like to show you. This is the overall. All type of the XEVs legislation in Thailand. On the left, as you can see, that the orange one showing the hybrid and plug-in hybrid, and on the green one is the battery electric vehicles. If you're talking about like the pure electric vehicles, as you can see that the during the last 2 years, 2019, 2020s. We have some of domestic increasing of the battery electric vehicles. As you can see, that the number is increasing from 2,800, and then from last year 2020, it's increased up to about 5,600. And then if you look at the specifically on the battery EVs type, you can see that. The majority of the electric vehicle is the motorcycle. So it's at the moment in the data on 30 of April, it's about 4,000, while the electric passenger vehicle is about half of it. And for the three wheeler or electric tuk-tuk, I'll use the tuk-tuk. So we have about 250 in Thailand. And then if you look at the for the new legislation for each year, as you can see that the as I mentioned earlier, the number of the battery we have been increasing quite a lot. So last year in 2020, we had almost 3,000 new electric vehicles legislation here in Thailand. And as you can see on the right, that if you look at the category of the vehicle, so the majority is the motorcycle, electric motorcycle, which is more than 50% of the total new legislation. I didn't talk much about the passenger vehicle, but I could have some number for the EV charging station for you too. We have about 600 station in Thailand. So recently in Thailand, we just have the the what we call the National Electric Vehicle Policy Committee, which is chaired by the Deputy Prime Minister. And the committee has been composed of high level from the government. For example, the Deputy Prime Minister itself, he's also the Minister of Energies. And also we have the Minister of Industry and Minister of Transport in the committees, and also many high-level officers from different ministry. For example, Ministry of Energy, Transport, Industry, and also Finance. So they put the key driver on this committee for the policy that we would like to go to the 100% of the new electric vehicle in 2035. Is that the three driver, that the important one is the we need to use electric vehicle for air pollution reduction, for the greenhouse gas reduction, and also would be opportunity for the new industry. And they have a vision that they would like to make Thailand a global production and supplying hub for electric vehicle and auto part. And also, this is probably my last slide here at the moment. So that the vision, as I mentioned, that they set the goal that in 2035, Thailand will be 100% zero emission vehicles, new sales by 2035. So that's our ultimate goal, which is another 14 years from here. But if we look at the on the specific on the electric motorcycle and also the electric tuk-tuk, you can see that in the target, we call the in 2030, we would like to have 30% of the motorcycle production would be electric vehicle or zero emission vehicle. And of course, that would be counting about 40% of the total sales. And in 2035, we hope that we'll be reached 100% of the sales in Thailand. So at the moment, the total of the new sale of the motorcycle is about 1.8 million. So we hope that from 2030, which is about 40%, and then the target will be 100% in 2035. And another thing is that when we are promoting the electric motorcycle, we would like to use the kind of the battery, the swappable. So we promote the using of these swapping station, swapping battery station. So we also having the target of, as in 2030, about 1,400 stations, and in 2035, with 1.8 million vehicles per year, we have about 4,000 stations. So that's the target. And for the electric tuk-tuk, maybe a little bit smaller number, because I think the there's not much of the growing business in tuk-tuk in Thailand, but we still would like to change all the electric tuk-tuk, the tuk-tuk in Thailand to be electric one. So as you can see that in for the electric tuk-tuk, the goal would be reaching the 100% of the total sales, which is about 2,200 per unit per year. And also we like to have that to be all production in Thailand too. Okay, I think that's it for me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yosapong. It's really good to see that Thailand has very clear targets and a lot of support from government. So I think now we can move to Vietnam with Professor Lian Tuan. Professor Lian Tuan, in Vietnam, sorry, can you hear me? Yeah. So Vietnam does not have a specific roadmap for e-mobility as of yet, but you have the most number of electric two-wheelers in Southeast Asia. It seems there is support for electric two-wheelers and e-vehicles in general because of industry initiatives in Vietnam. Can you update us on the government's and the industry support for these electric two-wheelers and electric mobility in general?
Okay, so good morning. Let me share my presentation. Okay. So I will focusing on the electric two and three wheelers in Vietnam. And let's say that in Vietnam, we the dominant mode of electric vehicles is electric two-wheelers. So the content of my talk will overview of electric two-wheelers development and policies for e-mobility deployed in Vietnam. First, about the electric two-wheeler developments. As you can see here that in this chart, it shows the penetration of the electric two-wheelers into the Vietnam's market, focusing on the electric motorcycles. So as you can see here that before 2018, the electric two-wheelers were mainly imported from China, Japan, and Korea. And the increasing rate of the of the electric motorcycles in 2017 is about 45%. But from 2018, VinFast started to introduce to the market the first model of Clara electric motorcycles. And let's say the annual growth rate increased to 47%, and the total electric two-wheelers is about 1 million in 2018. And 2019, a new two-wheeler, electric two-wheeler maker started to introduce a new model to Vietnam market. It is YAD, and you know they allocated their factory for electric two-wheeler productions, and the production capacity is about 200,000 electric two-wheeler per year. And let's say in the beginning of 2021, VinFast brought to two new models of electric two motorcycle to the market. And I would say that the potential market for electric two-wheelers in Vietnam is still very high because the share of motorcycle in circulation is about 92%. And it is the fourth largest motorcycle market in the world and the second in the region. And the domestic production and assembly in the period of 2014 to 2020, for e-bike, it is in downtrend. And for e-motorbike, it is uptrend, with the average growth rate of 46% per year. And the number of motorcycle manufacturer and assembled up to 2020 is about 1.35 million e-motorbike. And the import of electric two-wheelers in the period of 2014 to 2020, I would say that the number is very few because of the domestic production since 2016. And especially for e-motorcycles, it is a strong downtrend since 2015, but no more imported since 2016. And the total number of imported electric two-wheelers accounts for about 10%. And this chart shows the total electric two-wheelers registered in Vietnam's market. And for the year 2020, the total electric two-wheelers manufactured, assembled, and imported is about 250,000 electric motorcycles and electric bikes as well. In this chart show the sales of electric two-wheelers in Vietnam. And I just would like to focus on VinFast number. In 2020, VinFast sales over 100,000 electric motorbikes, two times higher compared to 2019. And in the first quarter of 2021, VinFast sold about 29,000 e-motorbike to the market, and increased about 20%, 21.6% compared to the same period last year. And the electric two-wheelers in circulation in Vietnam, let's say that in 2019, the annual growth rate is about 15%. And let's say that the electric motorcycles are forecasted to witness the fastest growth of about 19.1% in terms of fleet size during the period of 2018 to 2024. And here, this table shows some output from a survey conducted within our research project funded by GIZ. It is so that the battery type of electric motorcycles in Vietnam is mainly lead battery, and the lithium ion battery is share only about 14%, but this number will increase as the new model of VinFast electric motorcycle are mainly lithium ion batteries, and the swapping battery is a new approach that introduced by VinFast only, and it is increasing, but it's not within our survey, so the number is still zero in this table. And let me move to the policies for e-mobility deploy in Vietnam. This table also shows an output from our recent research funded by GIZ about the policy related to electric vehicle development in Vietnam, including the orientation, target roadmap, incentive, and vehicle management in the central level and the principal level. And you can see here for the electric two-wheeler, it is available including the manufacturers and also operation in the central level and provincial level. And I will say that even at this moment, we don't have the roadmap for electric mobility development in general, but the policies regarding national standards and regulation for electric two-wheelers are almost completed, and it is the very good basement for the electric two-wheeler development in Vietnam. And this table shows the integrating the e-mobility development into sustainable development strategy in some big cities. As I mentioned before, that our recent research focusing on developing the criteria for electric mobility development in the provincial levels, and 8 big cities were selected for our research, and this table mentioned about, let's say, something like the potential of e-mobility development for these 8 big cities. And from this research, one city at this moment already selected by the Ministry of Transport to further awarded to study and also developing the roadmap for electric vehicle development. And I hope that, you know, in some months to go, I will, if I have chance, I will introduce you about, you know, our further research on the roadmap development for electric vehicles in at least one big city in Vietnam. Okay, that's all from mine. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Leon. Okay, now we move to the Philippines. Mr. Edmund, the Philippines has had one of the earliest pilots in electric three-wheelers. So we had the e-trikes, and we also had e-jeeps. This was the first in Southeast Asia, starting in the late 2000s. However, the Philippines currently only has about 3,500 e-trikes and about 250 e-jeepneys. I guess our question is, why has the adoption of electric three-wheelers been slow? And there are some government support, particularly from the Department of Energy and the Asian Development Bank. But can you tell us what you think the government should be focusing on? And in terms of industry, what is needed to scale up efforts?
Okay, that's a good question. Well, there are three factors on why the rollout of e-trikes were slow. One is financing. The bulk of units deployed came from the EDB project in cooperation with the Department of Energy in providing local government units of about 100 to 200 e-trike units intended to roll out in their respective areas as their alternative public transportation and for social services. Most of the e-trike manufacturers doesn't have an access on financing schemes to offer the potential buyers or fleet operators. Second is programming. Government and private sectors must come up with a collaborative programs that entails green routes, or should we say in compliance with the Clean Air Act law, such replacements to the existing internal combustion engine operator users to an improved and environmental friendly vehicle. Issuance of new franchises exclusively for e-vehicles with identified areas of concerns as not to create conflicts with the existing ones of the tricycle operators. And then third is sustainability. One such program, if not given to a certain value, would end up a flop project. Be mindful that all types of vehicle has its own end of life, and to prolong it, such department or in-charge operator is necessary in addressing PMS or preventive maintenance and services, its monitoring of activities and tracking of performance. At present, our government is continuously developing the EV industry through its programs such as establishing standards through Technical Committee 89 under Bureau of Philippine Standards, EVIS program from DTI, encouraging local manufacturers to be more active through production of electric vehicles. Roadmaps for EV industries through the Board of Investment, which was established last 2014, and it is bound for an update and amendments. Another is on regulations through our lawmakers. And currently, the Electric Vehicle and Charging Stations Act Bill, or Senate Bill 1382, was approved on its Senate version. And its next phase is on the House Bill version for approval next month before it becomes a law under the current administration. The EV industry never stopped in spite of the pandemic situation, and we continuously promoting our advocacy to our list of our annual activities, such as the upcoming 9th Philippine EV Summit this coming August, and ongoing collaboration and participation on the government programs that I mentioned, and enticing investors that such potential is at stake in the Philippines. So those are the pressing concerns in addressing your questions, Ms. Pat. So hope I was able to address it. Thank you.
Yes. Sorry, my muted. Yes. Thank you, Edmund, for that. So thank you to all our panelists for their clear explanations of what's happening. So we've had a chance to look at the EV situation in Thailand, Vietnam, and the Philippines. And I think this, we have some time to take questions from the group. So feel free to type it in the chat or maybe raise your hand if you would like to ask your question live. But for now, I think maybe a follow-up question as well to all three of our panelists. Focusing again on what Bert asked earlier about the electric bicycles, are these being included in roadmaps and policies? And if they aren't, why do you think that's the case? Or do you think they should actually be included? So I know that we've heard from Professor Laan that there's a pretty slow uptake of e-bikes in Vietnam, but is that also something that should be considered in policy? Maybe we can follow the same round as earlier. And yeah, so we could invite Dr. Yosapong to answer for Thailand.
Right. Can you repeat the question again, please?
Yes. Are electric bicycles being considered in roadmaps and policies? And if they aren't, why do you think that's the case? And is there a case to be made to actually include them?
Right. Of course, if you want to go to do the electric mobilities in your in the country, I think you in the case like Thailand, we didn't not just consider one type of the vehicle. Actually, we cover all the type of vehicles. The presentation I show you is only show the target for the electric motorcycle and electric tuk-tuk. But in fact, we look at the all type of vehicle from the electric passenger car, electric truck, bus, even a boat, a ferry. So basically, we look at the overall of the all type of the transport vehicles that should be electrified, become an electrified vehicle. So of course, the electric motorcycle, which is we have in Thailand, we have about 20 million vehicle use registration in Thailand. That is one of the very important sector. So that's why in Thailand we include the electric motorcycle, and also of course the electric tuk-tuk is one of the famous in Thailand, so we include it into the part of the policy that we are promoting the use of electric mobilities. Actually, I have two more slides about to show the if that okay to show the some of the startup about the electric motorcycle in Thailand. Can you see my presentation? Okay, this is two companies, Thai companies, a startup companies that they try to promote the they develop the our own brand in Thailand. So one of the companies called E-tran, so they developed the several models of the electric motorcycle, and also another one is called Edison Motor. They also develop very nice electric scooter in Thailand, and also the existing company like Honda in Thailand. They are working with me in KMUTT that we are developed this showcase of the electric motorcycle station. So it's kind of smart station that you can see that they can use for the their battery swapping station here, and apart at the station we also including the solar panels. So we try to use the solar energy to charge it into this the battery swapping station. And we have been doing this for during last 2 years. Yeah. Unfortunately, sometimes we have to close the station because of the COVID situation. But anyway, we have kept some good data that this kind of the model and this going to be the kind of using the swapping batteries station will be one of the promotion strategy in Thailand for electric motorcycle. And also, this is another example in Thailand that we have the startup companies called MoveMe. So they use the electric tuk-tuk as the ride hailing. So you can call electric tuk-tuk, and you can share electric tuk-tuk too, you know, in Thailand. And this electric tuk-tuk produced in Thailand. Yeah, I'd like to share this a few startup companies that they are working with. So even though like this company, like Honda, they are working with a startup company called Hopcar, which is a startup company. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Yosepong. Okay, we ask the same question to Professor Le Antoine. Why are e-bikes not considered in policy so far?
Thank you. I would say that e-bike is also one mode of the electric vehicles. So for sure that it must be considered in the roadmap and also policies as well. But, you know, I have not mentioned the e-bike policies in my presentation because it is the trend that, you know, since VinFast appeared in the Vietnam market since 2018, you know, electric motorcycle is mainly produced domestically. And, you know, the e-bike, therefore, only imported, let's say, mainly imported. And the e-bike imported increase, but reduce in production domestically in Vietnam. And let's say that the technical standard and regulation for e-bike is, of course, available at this moment. But as I mentioned, that the roadmap for electric vehicles is not built yet, and therefore, you know, the roadmap is not available for e-bike and also for other electric vehicle modes in Vietnam at this moment.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Le An. We ask the same question now to Mr. Edmund from the Philippines.
Yes. Thanks, Pat. With regards to the Philippine setting, as of the moment, we are still waiting for the administrative order from our land transportation office on the categories of each and every vehicles, from e-mobility of the e-bikes up to the e-vehicles of the four wheels. And that is part and parcel of the plan of the government. However, unfortunately, we haven't received yet the final that they say that's for signature for the approval of these categories. This would somehow elevate on giving such priority on the e-bikes as well. And at the same time, the government is keen on localizing such e-vehicles, but not most of the investors are not keen on producing local e-bikes here in the Philippines, but they are focusing on the public transportation use on the e-trikes and the e-jeeps that is existing. So unfortunately, there are some slow approach, like some of the our counterpart who lobbying for bike lanes on major roads that can be used even on the e-bikes are some that can be compared to others. But in terms of having it on a broad opportunity, well, the existing of the e-bikes here are mostly on imported ones, mm-hmm. mostly from China. And it really needs to address its policies on its users because most of the users are not keen on following instructions and rules and regulations on road courtesy and safety regulations. I think you would attest to it that because you are living in the Philippines as well, no? So that's the irony about it. But we are looking forward that we can also tap on the concerns of the e-bike users as well.
Thank you for that, sir. So it's interesting, we're hearing similarities that e-bikes are generally imported and that while there are no policies, we are waiting for them. It seems like it's being worked on. I think we have time for one last question, if that's okay with Britt and Michelle.
Yeah, I think you can do one more.
Okay, thank you. So this is for Dr. Yosapong. The question is, where is the incentive for electric tuk-tuk manufacturers in Thailand if the Department of Land Transport doesn't issue new license or registration plates for these EVs?
Right. I think that's true. They're not actually allowed to have the, at the moment, the regulation that you cannot register the electric any tuk-tuk for the taxi tuk-tuk. I mean for the but you can do the tuk-tuks for the personal use, and some city like in Chiang Mai, they have some quota that you can register electric tuk-tuk, the new electric tuk-tuk. So the idea is that we have been discussed with the Department of Land Transport. They prefer that we try to replace the old tuk-tuk with the new electric tuk-tuk. But still some challenging because of there's no expiry date to the old, to the existing tuk-tuk. So most of the tuk-tuk will not seem to be likely to change it because they cost more. So some of the challenges they are under this discussions, what is the incentive for this electric tuk-tuk? So hopefully with this target, they will try to come up with some of the idea and the incentive for the electric tuk-tuk manufacturer in Thailand.
Thank you, Dr. Yosapong, and I hope that answered the question from the chat. There is also another question in the chat, but maybe our panelists can just type the answer in the chat as well. And I will turn it back over now to Bert to transition for the second panel.
Thank you very much, Pat. Definitely there are more questions. This financial help from governments on purchase of e-vehicles, I believe we don't have this in any of the Southeast Asian countries or any even for other Asian countries, only in China that they have this. But our speakers, please, if you have answers, let us know later. So without further ado, I think let's go to our next panel. We will have an opportunity later on to discuss more. And I turn over the facilitation for this session to Michelle Ahn from GIZ and DCTIA Initiative for Asia.
Thank you very much, Pat. As you already said, my name is Michelle, and I work as an advisor for MRV and low carbon transport at GIZ office in Hanoi, and for working for the NDC Transport Initiative for Asia. And I think living in a country where 90% of vehicles are two-wheelers, and at the same time, air pollution levels are so high that you can see it really every day, electrification of two and three-wheelers really seems just to make sense to me. However, we wouldn't have this panel if it would be that easy and we could just like do it and it would happen by itself. So I'm very happy that I'm joined today by four experts who have gathered hands-on experience on introducing electric two-wheelers to discuss what are the prospects for electric two and three-wheelers in ASEAN and how can we successfully bring them on the road. And I'd like to invite my panelists to switch on their cameras if they haven't done so and introduce Anton Surf, the transport chief of Pasig City in the Philippines, who has managed to have under his leadership Pasig working on integrated and shared urban logistics. And I'm also welcoming Hien Nguyen, who's working at the University for Transport and Technology in Hanoi in Vietnam and recently launched a pilot on a shared scooter scheme in Hanoi. And I'm welcoming Nu Vong, who works at the National Energy Center of Thailand and has been working on the ASEAN fuel economy roadmap and is now involved in electric two and three-wheeler policies. And I'm also welcoming Faela Sufa, who's the director from IPDP Indonesia and who has been obviously very instrumental in achieving a lot of sustainable transport policies in Indonesia, but also around all ASEAN. And I'd like to start with Anton. And we understand that PASIC is well known for its progressive policies on sustainable transport, and the city has probably implemented more sustainable transport measures than any other city in Metro Manila. And could you tell us more about PASIC's vision and plans for electric mobility? And do you actually see electric two-wheelers supporting sustainable transport in the city?
Yeah, so Michelle, actually, thank you very much for having me on the panel. I think the way you put it there, where we talk about electric mobility having a part of sustainable, being a part of our sustainable transport plans, actually describes it quite well. I think the right way to talk about electric mobility is that it does not stand as a separate program from having a good public transportation, from having safe streets, and from having a good walking and cycling. In fact, electric mobility, in our view, is integral to all these programs, especially because you're able to provide private travel that is low emission, that is safe, and that is less congestive to more people of your population. I think we want to encourage electric mobility because it really is a good tool to use in the fight against climate change, urban pollution, and dangerous roads. So I think for us, especially when we talk about electric mobility and two-wheelers, it's really not its own program, but as an enhancement almost to the program of cycling and road safety. Because as we all know, cycling, one of the fair criticisms against it, even though we all know it's good, is that it's not exactly available to everybody, especially depending on the state of your road network. And when you introduce electric two-wheelers to that, then you make cycling type travel available to so many more people, especially people of different ages and physical ability.
Thank you very much. Faela, I understand that Jakarta has won the Sustainable Transport Award last year, and you have been really instrumental in this. And would you actually agree with Anton? Do you also agree that bringing electric vehicles on the road is really important? You're muted.
Thank you, Michelle. We really delighted that last year Jakarta won a Sustainable Transport Award, and it's because of the improvement of transportation integrations. And then what we've see that the first and last mile connectivity is very important, actually. Not only the main modes, for example, like the MRT or commuter rail, and also Transjakarta, which is the BRT system, but the first and last mile connectivity, which currently dominated with two-wheelers, ICE two-wheelers, is very important to be transformed as well. If we want to talk the electrifications, I think one of the modes that we can first electrify is the two-wheelers, because of two-wheelers in Jakarta mainly, the share is really huge, around 70% compared to other modes. And then regarding the electric bicycles, so we give technical assistance to the city of Jakarta to implement the bike sharing system. And then one of it, the bike sharing operators, they are introducing the e-bike. And on top of that, the ride-hailing companies in Jakarta, like Grab Food, So they are using bicycle electric to deliver the food to the customers. I think that's gonna be like a huge impact if we can also incorporate like the electrification in our bigger transportation system.
Right, I'm glad to hear this. And Ms. Hen, I know that you have been working in Hanoi on electric scooter sharing schemes actually, and you're still investing in that. And where do you see the prospect of that, and how do you see the general perception of electric two-wheelers in Vietnam?
Thank you, Misha. I'm from the University of Transport Technologies, and currently we are doing on two electric mobility projects focusing on two-wheeler. The first one is an ITI PMU supported project called Mainstream Electric Mobility that we work with the UNEP to implement this one. And we have just finished the project. And in that project, we also conduct a survey on the perception and the certification of the user when they use a two-wheeler, electric two-wheelers. And the other project is called the Solution Plus project that is supported by the European Commission. And we are working with 46 international partners to do the demonstration in Hanoi. And in that demonstration, we introduced the sharing electric two-wheelers to connect the passengers from BRT station to the shopping mall. So basically, I can just give you some image on the perception of the public to the electric two-wheelers in Vietnam. Just to give you a very interesting number, that in the first quarter of 2021, there are 25,000 electric motorcycles are newly registered in Vietnam. So the number saying that more and more Vietnamese people are changing to use electric two-wheelers these days, and with the positive attitude. We cannot deny that the electric two-wheeler showing advantage to gasoline one regarding of their design, the smart control, the environmental friendliness, and also the fuel cost saving. Actually in Vietnam, the electric two-wheelers were introduced in early 2000s. And at that time, the user are mostly students and people going from home to school early. But nowadays, the user are more diverse, like employees, the government officials, the civil servants, and even some like elderly. So we see the very positive changing from the traditional vehicle to the electric vehicle in Vietnam. And I hope that other cities in Asia and Southeast Asia witness the same things like us in Vietnam. So I can say that the potential for the electric two-wheelers is very big in Vietnam, and especially in the big city like Hanoi, Ho Chi Minh City, and other major cities scattering around Vietnam. That is, just give you some like general perception.
Thank you. Maybe one follow-up question. You've said that now the perception really changed from, in the beginning it was mainly students using electric two-wheelers, and now it's like a broader part of society. Would you have any reasons why now more people are using electric two-wheelers?
Yes, people see the convenience is usability, and they are very satisfied with the very good advantage of the electric two-wheelers. Like they can save the money for buying gasoline instead of that, just charging the electricity very like economically. Then also people like the young people are more keen on buying electric two-wheeler because it is more technological. They can use smart control, and they also are very easy to manage their vehicle. So I think also the perception on the environmental protection is more raised now among the young people. So people aware that using electric vehicle is more good to environment, so that they change their mind to use this one. Yep.
Thank you. Mr. Nuvong, would you agree on what Hen said about people's perception of electric two-wheelers? And is that really the same? Is that the same for Thailand? And I know we have heard about the commitments of the country also in relation to electric two-wheelers. And could you tell us really how the perception changed over the last years for people? And I mean, we see now all these ads also about electric cars. And do people still want to invest in electric two-wheelers?
Yes, I think while I'm speaking, I think can I share the screen just to elaborate? I think some of the visual that I am going to explain. I think, can you all see my screen now?
Yes.
Okay, so I think in Thailand it's different, I think, because usually people who use motorcycle in Thailand tend to use it at a very high speed. So in fact, I think with the cost per performance at the moment, I think the ICE motorcycle is actually deliver, I think, faster speed at a given budget constraint. So I think in Thailand, I think as you hear from Professor Yusapong, that we have a very strong policy push, you know, coming from the National EV Policy Committee, which also including, you know, three-wheelers. So in this case, I just show you this picture that that's to support my point that I think the perception and popularity in Thailand for electric two-wheeler is actually coming in the commercial sector more. So that if you look at the upper left corner, this is basically just a project by an electric motorcycle company with one university. And because this university is located outside Bangkok, so it's a very large campus, so the motorcycle taxi are very popular to be smart mobility when you have taking the bus to the university. And also they are also realize, I think, the fact that the battery swap could enhance the usage of this electric motorcycle taxi because of the busy operation audit, and they don't have time to charge it during the day. And also you look at on the upper right corner, this is actually coming from the National Grid company, and they are actually doing this to help supporting the electric motorcycle nearby in the headquarters. And of course, because of them as an electric producer of the country, then they have to diversify the portfolio so that they can actually try to maintain the status of electricity generating position in Thailand, and also helping, you know, reducing the emission at the same time. And you look in the bottom left corner, this is coming from, you know, basically the DHL company, and they are actually, I think, one of the company that deliver the package, I think, for parcel. And they also under the global movement on reducing transportation emissions. So that's why I think they have introduced also 50 electric two-wheeler in their fleet in Africa to show their responsibility with their charging. And you look in the upper lower right corner, this is actually coming from a national oil company, one of them. We have two national oil company, and also they are thinking of diversifying the portfolio. I think they are also trying to tap into the market of electric mobility, and especially teaming up with the motorcycle taxi station so that they can somehow encourage this battery swapping so that they can encourage the long driving range. And I think what Dr. Yusapong showed earlier, that one of the startup company that he showed actually coming from another oil company. So you can see that the transition of having electric mobility actually widespreading, you know, in various sectors of the commercial sector. And my last slide here, just to tap on, I think there was some discussion that, you know, everyone talk about electric motorcycle, but electric bike, you know, per se, and why is it? And I must say that in Thailand, it's not very popular either. And one thing could be that I think similar to other countries, that the climate is very hot, and also the infrastructure that may be more dangerous for the bicycle user on the road to be a target for the bigger truck that running on the same road, you know, with the higher speed. So this is just to show you that, you know, there are some people actually like the biking, and they're also offering like a zero emission delivery service, like you can see here. And even the riding the tour, and these are actually to provide this non-motorized transport, you know, in the term of electric bike. And also we have some of the company that's actually selling that, you know, for commercial transition. But when they talk to them and they say that this electric bike is not as much popular as the electric motorcycle, as we can show by the statistic of the new registration by Dr. Yusupong. So in overall, from your to answer your question, basically, I think the popularity and also acceptability of this electric two-wheeler in Thailand would rather come from the commercial sector, which also under the national roadmap that Dr. Yusupong has presented earlier. And I think that we are also trying to maintain this electric, maintain the industry for making this electric motorcycle, even though the market share of Thailand for the ICE motorcycle is actually 70% or 80% Japanese brand. So this is one of the things that the government is trying to push, if there are possibility of having this national brand in Thailand as well. So that with that, I think I have been my sharing presentation.
Thank you. Anton, I think Nuvong touched upon a very interesting point, like looking at commercial suppliers actually pushing for electric two-wheelers. And I understand that in Pasig City, for example, DHL is now pushing into electric two and three-wheelers. Could you tell us a bit more about that?
I think the next real key, I think, breakthrough for electric two-wheelers in the Philippines. I think if you look around, we're still in the process of like collecting all the data, but you can really see that electric mobility is being adopted by many households in the Philippines for private travel. I think especially people who find conventional motorcycles and motor scooters not accessible, too expensive. And I think one piece of feedback we've gotten especially is that for people with disabilities, I think if your physical condition cannot handle the torque and the forces of a gas-powered vehicle, I think the acceleration and the torque forces of a electric vehicle are much easier for certain people's bodies to tolerate. So I think the next step really is to go from that, from household use to commercial and to logistics use actually. And in addition to DHL, we've had a project with the local post office where we got a grant from UNEP and the and also from the like a Chinese e-bike company to actually help us convert the fleet of delivery vehicles for the post office into electric two and three wheelers. And I think the feedback has been good so far. I think of course there's an adjustment period where the methods of maintenance for these vehicles are different from conventional vehicle fleets in the Philippines. And so there's been a bit of a challenge in terms of like scheduling those processes, because of course you don't fill them up with gas in the same way. You can charge them, but of course, eventually at some point, you have to do things like replace the battery and repair the controller, and you have to employ different types of professionals. You know, instead of the engineers, the mechanical engineers, you need to employ the electricians to help you with this. So I think it's been quite challenging, but I think the results have been quite good, and I think it's encouraging for other city operations. Like we also use the e-bikes and electric three-wheelers actually in the health operations. If there are people who are, I think, suspected positive for COVID-19 and they have no means to get to the testing center, we've been using the electric vehicles, which are open air, to fetch them from their houses and to bring them in for testing, because it's much safer than being in an air-conditioned vehicle. So I think that's also another way in which it's been helpful to our city government operations.
Great. I think as we are in a policy discussion, it would be interesting to also understand what policy mechanisms you used to actually achieve that. Like how did you push for this electric vehicles to get on the road and for the operators to use them and to bring them in?
Okay. Yeah, I think one thing we've been trying to do, because, okay, I think what people also must understand about the Philippines is that there is no real local regulation of vehicle standards. In terms of like the general permission of types of standards for vehicles, it's really something done at the national level. But one thing we have been trying to do for electric vehicles is that we've been basically incorporating our safe street infrastructure for cycling and making that available to electric vehicles as well. Because I think one of the positions we've taken is that electric vehicles, like electric two-wheelers, if you operate them at a safe speed, it's like having an electric bicycle. And obviously, if they run at like, many electric vehicles are lower power, so they cannot run like over 30 kilometers per hour like motor scooters. So I think when you create like a safe bicycle lane and safe bicycle parking, then that infrastructure can also be used by electric vehicles to expand the range and the effective area where people can do business. So really, at our level, we believe that safe cycling infrastructure is also safe electric two-wheeler infrastructure. And we've been trying to develop towards that.
Excellent. Glad to hear. Bela, I understood that like Jakarta implemented, I think, 60 kilometers of new bike routes during COVID. And I mean, now we heard that like electric vehicles can be pushed by safe cycling infrastructure. What role do electrified bikes play actually on these routes? And also we heard from Nuwong that like it's really difficult to bring people to cycle. So yeah, maybe you could elaborate a bit on that.
Actually, that I'm glad that Anton bring this up because I think the electrification of the two-wheeler, it can be a momentum as well to regulate them. As we understand, like in cities in Southeast Asia, so two-wheelers will be like our big problem to manage, actually, as a transport planner. So because they are ambiguity, like their positions. So we have like sidewalk for cyclists, and sidewalk for pedestrians, sorry, and then bicycle lane for cyclists, and then traffic lane for car, and we also have like dedicated median lane for BRT. But where is the positions of two-wheelers? And I think whether it's like mixed with mixed traffic, but how we can regulate them. I think this momentum of electrification of two-wheeler can also be our chance to also regulate them. So to have them like regulate on the traffic lane light, for example, and then to regulate their speed, I think, and then to make sure their safety as well, because we understand that most of the traffic accident in here, mainly in Indonesia, is caused by two-wheelers. And what Anton mentioned earlier, that we have like safe bicycle lanes. Yes, but the bicycle lanes is designed to only accommodate the bicycles, which is the pedal cyclists and also electric bicycles, which has limitations of speed, 25 kilometer per hour if is it in Indonesia. But motorcycle, they usually have bigger than that, because the range of their travel is higher than when compared to using bicycles. Maybe bicycles only like less than 4 kilometer. But if you want to ride motorcycles, you will travel more than 10 kilometers. So I think we have a planner, like a city planner or urban planner, we have, this is our momentum to answer the challenge how we can regulate the two-wheelers in our cities with the electrification. And this is to make sure that safety as well, because we, especially in Jakarta, most of the traffic accident is caused by the crash of two-wheelers. Yeah.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I'd like to also use this opportunity to invite everybody to write your questions into the chat so we can also pick them up. And looking at the regulation of two-wheelers, maybe Nuvong, you could also outline in which direction that is going into in Thailand and like what your work is in that direction.
Thank you, Michael. I think basically for the past, I would say 5 years, I think Department of Land Transport, which is an authority who laid the standard for any bicycle or any car. Of course, you know, they are concerned about the safety, things like that. So we have a special, I think, criteria that regulating the electric motorcycle. So for example, it has to maintain, you know, on the roller, the motorcycle dynamometer, at least like for 50 kilometers per 30 minutes, you know, to make sure that the performance is okay, that it doesn't, because in Thailand, I think we have a combination of very nice road and also people are very like to do in a fast pace. So that's why I think we also suffer like in Indonesia that we have a lot of casualty coming from the motorcycle. On the other hand, also we are also trying now that beside the regulation and also the safety regulation, I think that's also, you know, no matter what, if you are riding the motorcycle that using the gasoline or electricity, you still need to, you know, perform, I mean, adhere to the safety regulation, as well as I think additional one coming from this, I think the electricity for charging, I think for motorcycle, even though the voltage and also the ampere is not much, but they need to make sure that because right now we only have like 1,000, you know, like millions in Vietnam, so we still have, we still have early stage that we could potentially, you know, try to framework it in such a way that it can use more sustainably and also as another option for the mobility for the different sector of the people in Thailand. Yes.
Hien, thank you. Hien, I think what becomes clear here is that countries are going in different directions, actually. Like, I feel like in Vietnam, we had that situation where people are now moving towards bigger bikes, and the regulation is really also looking at unifying all the bikes together into one big category. What do you think about the other countries' approaches in that direction?
Regarding to the like combining all kind of e-two-wheeler into one kind, I think that shouldn't be in some way that shouldn't be combining all the thing into one category, because there will be different standard and regulation for each kind of vehicle. So maybe we can categorize into some typical criteria as in ASEAN country. So I believe that you in some place or somehow you know about the development of standard for electric two-wheeler in ASEAN country. So this can be considered for the Vietnamese policymaker to consider for that category.
Excellent. Thank you very much. From the audience, we get a lot of questions regarding electricity and how bicycles can be charged and like what does that mean for the grid, and also in terms of battery treatment in cycles and probably range anxiety. And also we have a question about the source of electricity in the respective countries. Maybe we do a quick round, I would suggest, to comment on this. Nuvong, would you like to start?
Sure. I think with the grid, of course, I think that's also depending, always a question. You know, when you're using the electric mobility, you're not emitting the emission at the mobility source, but also you emission at the grid, right? So in Thailand, we still, with the power development plan of Thailand, we need to reduce the emission, you know, in the near future and also as a step. And we try to, right now, 70% coming from natural gas. So we try, of course, you know, at some bit of coal, but we try to increase, I think, more renewable energy so that we can reduce the energy footprint. And also with that regarding emission, and also about the battery, I think that's also a good point, that because at the early stage also, not only the safety regulation for using the vehicle play, but also the safety regulation to make sure that the used battery after the life cycle has been care of. So this one, the Ministry of Industry are now formulating the policy so that it has to be somehow managed and take back by the producer so that they properly maintain or recycle those batteries. And we must admit that I think comparing between lithium ion and so lead acid battery, the lithium battery itself has a recycle business established for a long time. I think we're using lead acid for a long time, but for lithium ion battery, I think we still need some kind of regulation and also some kind of the methodology to make sure that it doesn't leak into the other system and to get potentially poisoning for other people. Yeah. Thank you.
Anton, how do you deal with the electricity supply and the grid?
Yeah, I think right now, to be honest, in the Philippines, we don't really have a lot of commercial charging stations that are outside of households or office buildings where the or like private fleets are charged in garages. But we're working on establishing some in partnership with local property owners, where you can have like a little pay charging while you park the vehicle, basically as part of your as part of the pay parking. The I think with the electricity supply in the Philippines, while we do have quite a bit of renewable energy, it's not like we have many charging stations where we can really say that the source of the electric vehicle charging is purely renewable. This is something which I think our grid is or the people with our grid are still working on providing and developing. But I think as we get to more electric vehicles, especially electric two-wheelers, I think then we'll see maybe even some off-grid connections where you have direct solar to electric vehicle charging, as I think some jurisdictions are trying to do.
Kayla. You're still muted.
I'm still muted. As we know that in Indonesia, most of our grid sources is still from coal, but the national government, they have committed that I think 2030, they will have more share on the renewable energy. If I'm not mistaken, it's around 29%. But yeah, we need to work really hard on that. And then solar PV, no, we are like exploring to use solar PV as an alternative grid. But actually in Java Island, so we have like a surplus grid supply or electricity supply. So electrification could be the answer for that. In terms of the charging infrastructure, I think we are still limited compared to another cities in Asia. But the national grid company, which is PLN in Indonesia, so they already give like an incentive mainly for the industry like Transjakarta. They will like charge lower to use the electricity grid for electric vehicles. And then So in terms of solar PV, usually if like the excess of solar PV, we can buy the national grid company can buy back the excess of solar PV that we produce, but with the lower price. But the government now wants to have like a similar price when we they will get excess of solar PV. I think that's a good incentive of using renewable energy. And right. Even though we are still using like coal as our main source of the grid, But if we are electrify, like most of the two-wheelers in Jakarta, for example, we can have we can reduce around like 500,000 CO2 equivalents per year. Actually, that's a huge impact of the electrifications. Yeah.
That really sounds like a lot of CO2 saved. Hien, maybe you could also quickly comment on that. I think you muted.
Yeah, I think the Vietnamese government is promoting many initiatives and also the policy for electric two-wheelers. In particular, and also electric vehicle in general. So for that one, now the government is paying more attention to like giving more preference and also more advantage to electric two-wheeler by taxis, and also giving more privilege for the producer of the electric vehicle. Like in Vietnam, you see the very big producer, Covinfast. Now they are introducing like electric bus, electric car, and electric two-wheelers. So that is a very like positive signal of the country to be to use or to bring up the electric vehicle into the country. So that one, I think Vietnam together with Asian country will see the big lift in this e-mobility. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We have one question from Namira directly for Faela. And it is about cycling and characterizing electric bicycles in respect to other motorized vehicles, and what can planners do to change people's perspective on a big group of cyclists, and how would it affect people to actually cycle to commute?
Yeah, I hope I answer your questions. If we are living in Jakarta, most of the people, like my colleagues in the office, we are living on the outskirts of Jakarta, actually, that we need to travel more than 10 kilometers in one direction. In one direction. So, yeah, I understand it's very difficult to cyclists, but we can mix commute, actually. So public transport in Jakarta now, they are providing bicycle facilities. So, for example, we can carry our bicycles to go to the nearest train stations. And then there is facilities for ramp, and then also like a bike park at the train stations. And then once we reach our destination, which is in CBD area, we still can carry our bikes, but we can also park our bikes safely in the station near our residential. And then in the city center, Jakarta plan to provide like bicycle sharing system. If we don't have bike, we don't need to own bike, actually. Which hopefully this year we can Jakarta can deploy more than 2,000 bike in the CBD's area. So that's the plan. I think if we can, as the government provide like good infrastructure, safe for women, children, elderly, or maybe our friends like disabilities, the people will come, like the cyclists will come.
Thank you. That nicely transitions me to my final and concluding question for this session. And what I'd like to know from you is also about how to bridge the last mile. And I think in Europe and in the US, we see more and more of these little kick scooter thingies coming up in everywhere, basically, and popping up that could potentially bridge the last mile. And I'd like to know from all of you, basically, do you see this as a viable solution for Southeast Asia? Do you see them coming to also your countries? And do you think that could help bridging this last mile in terms of, like, because like stations might be too far away? And how about the sharing culture in all the countries? Do you think sharing vehicles can really work?
Yeah, for Vietnam, I think the sharing system could work for last mile connectivity. And one of the evidence that we are now doing the pilot project or demonstration for last mile connectivity between the BRT station, and later on we can expand to like metro station or monorail, so that the people will see the effectiveness, the cost effective of the sharing system, when many people can share one e-scooter or one vehicle to travel from one place to other place. So this is exactly what we are doing for last mile connectivity in our project in Hanoi now.
Yeah. May I speak, Michelle?
Yes, sure.
Yeah,
okay.
I think regarding the e-scooter, there is a debate here whether it's safe or not. Like cities, they ban e-scooters. Jakarta is also currently ban e-scooters. I think we can use e-scooter as last mile connectivity, but we need to regulate them, like the speed and then how they park. So we shouldn't park on the sidewalk that will be occupy all of the pedestrian space. And then we need to also make sure that the user, the e-scooter users, capable to use e-scooters. And then maybe the time, because the accident that happened in Jakarta last time is during early morning, 5 a.m. in the morning. So yeah, I think with the good regulations from the operators, the education as well, e-scooters can be one of the last mile modes in our cities.
Thank you very much. Anton, I think this is a question that also goes to you. I mean, I think cities around the world are really discussing on this. So maybe you could also shed some light on what you're thinking.
Yeah, I think with the devices you just showed, like the e-scooters, I think we don't really have that many shared programs for them. I think there's one part of Manila where you can rent them to kind of just go around, but not really for journey purposes, mostly just recreational. But people also have been owning these e-scooters privately, and I think have been using them similar to bicycles to commute for the same distance. Because I think even the ones that you showed, they do have a range of basically maybe up to 30 kilometers on one charge, which is enough. I mean, if you're commuting it's just 5 to 10 kilometers, then it's really more than enough to serve your journey every day. I do think maybe for the sharing type of e-scooters, there are some questions we have to resolve. I think when you look at the record of the sharing companies here, I think there are still big questions about whether it's really economical. I think I don't know of any of the sharing companies that are profitable just on the operation alone, which means that if you have them in your city, either you're relying on the subsidy of the owners taking a loss, or the government will have to subsidize them at some point. And then I think there's a big question about whether that's a good thing. In terms of the safety, I think we still believe it's really important to have a safe infrastructure, especially for the scooters where the speed is a little lower. But I think also you have to combine this with the general road safety effort, because even if these electric scooters are not safe, you can just look at the safety records of motorized motorcycles and motorized cars. And I think, it's quite a fair question. If we're going to limit the speeds of these electric scooters, then we should definitely also maybe think about limiting the speeds of the larger vehicles. I think even Faela, I can see, also agrees with this. It's really something which has to be discussed, I think. So yeah, thank you. Definitely very interesting.
Thanks. Nuvang, I think yes, Thailand is among the countries that really invest also in massive public transport infrastructure. Can this really bridge the last mile?
Yes, I think in the sharing mobility, I think we have some startup. I think like what Dr. Yosung mentioned earlier, and also the startup company are also trying to pitch themselves as a sharing company with the environmental friendly option. So of course they have they start up with just regular car or motorcycle or scooter, but now they're expanding to the electric motorcycle, electric car first at the moment. And I think in terms of the scooter, like what you showed earlier, in Thailand, a lot of people use more, I think, especially for the young generation. Of course, you know, for Thailand, I think we have to change our culture. Like when I was graduating from college, the first thing I want to buy is a car, because, you know, we need to be able to drive to work. But now, the new graduate student, they want to buy a condo. They don't care about the car. So the ownership of car has become something that like a burden to them. So they are all toward on sharing movie, and they want to get like a condo that near the MRT with this little, you know, a scooter for them to commute. I think that trend has been changing, but of course with the weather like this and also sometimes raining and flooding, as you can see, and it still have some challenges to make it more sustainable and also popular by itself without the subsidy, like what Anton has mentioned. I agree with that. Yes.
Excellent. Thank you very much. And I think that's good final words, actually. People don't want to buy a car anymore. They'd rather invest in a condo. And I think over the discussion, we saw that this is really also a classic push-pull effect field where we need to push for certain minimum standards. And at the same time, we can really use this to pull sustainable development off. And with that, I'd like to hand back to Bert, and thank you very much to all the panelists for this very interesting discussion.
Thank you very much, Michelle, and the panelists. Very good discussions. I think always we don't have a lot of time. I don't want to make a summary, but I just like to highlight a few things. National policies. I think many of our countries in Southeast Asia, and you will realize that, are using electric mobility, electric motorcycle, electric cars production to spur economic growth. You will see that in Thailand, Vietnam, some countries would have targets. Many countries have announced only having 2030 by 2035 sales of electric vehicles or electric motorcycles in that case. But you also see the example of Vietnam, where there is really no target. Policies are there to support, and they have the highest number of electric two-wheelers in production. So that issue on national policies, manufacturing support is very important. These policy guidelines that we did together with the EV associations in Thailand, Philippines, Singapore, Malaysia, and Vietnam, it's important because our countries in Southeast Asia particularly are just at this time trying to decide what kind of speed or how do you regulate an electric bicycle with a 1000 watt motor with a top speed of 60 kilometers per hour. Can it go to the bike lane? Should it be in mixed traffic? Where do you put these things into perspective? Do the people need a license? So these questions we have tried to answer together with the EV associations and experts in the region, and it's in the policy guidelines. In terms of usage in traffic, we are going to work together with the Institute for Transportation and Development Policy, with PHYLA, to investigate this further. Like, how do we regulate the integration of electric bicycles, electric motorcycles, the kick scooters, the electric kick scooters in traffic, last mile connectivity, these kind of things. So we hope to also be able to go back on these issues next time. There are so many technical issues, technical questions, which is very good. I go back to this issue on manufacturing. I think this is a very good opportunity for the countries in Southeast Asia, which are all very competitive, by the way, and I guess this is for other countries as well, in terms of spurring economic growth through manufacturing. You see that in Thailand, there are now so many startups on electric two-wheelers. In Vietnam, basically, the whole growth of this electric two-wheeler production is spurred by one company, VinFast. There will be positive and negative impacts on our transport system. There will be problems, definitely, battery management, recycling, reuse. What we need to do, I think, as experts, but also just citizens of these countries in Southeast Asia, we must work with our governments to make sure that appropriate policies are in place. And let's try to make use of this electric mobility revolution or electric two and three wheelers to support sustainable transport. Like, we are not supporting technology replacement of motorcycles and cars, but we are trying to support a better sustainable transport system for our cities. So electric bicycles has a role. They have a role to play, and we should keep it and make sure that we discuss with our cities, with our national government, that it has a rightful place. I think that's really all for me. And I want to thank definitely our partners, Michelle and Pat. This is a very good, very engaging discussions. Our panelists, Yosapong, Edmund, Tuan, we will have this round next time. Anton, Nuwong, Hien, Faila, definitely all these discussions we will have again. This is one of the few sessions, I guess, that has a focus on this maybe niche market, but for Southeast Asia, this is a very large sector, electric two and three wheelers. And I think we should keep it that way. Let's keep on talking about it as our government policy decision makers hear about it, and also industry players support it. So I think with all that, thank you very much. And I really appreciate you all, the discussions, also to our participants. I'm sorry we don't have time to answer all the questions. Thank you, and see you in the next sessions.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Stay safe. Bye.
Bye.